ओके जी, बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। वेलकम टू अनदर लेक्चर ऑफ मॉडर्न कंट्रोल सिस्टम्स। आई एम योर प्रेजेंटर मोहम्मद राफिज उख्ताई। सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस सम फर्दर कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ द मैथमेटिकल मॉडलिंग ऑफ सिस्टम्स एंड विल गो डीपर इनटू द फ्यू बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स दैट यू हैव टू हैव इन योर माइंड फॉर फ्यूचर स्टडीज एंड फॉर दिस कोर्स एज वेल। So first of all, we will see what is linear approximation. Linear approximation of a physical system. Linear approximation of a physical system. So I would like to just note down the points or the you can say the titles that we are discussing in this lecture or the concepts that we will discuss. I will list down the concepts that we will discuss in this lecture on this page, and we'll discuss the basic concepts on subsequent pages so that we can recap it quickly. So now, what is the linear approximation of a physical system? First of all, you have studied in your signal systems, and you people must know what is a linear system. What is a linear system? If I say there is a system y is equal to x, is it a linear system? You all will say yes. However, if I say there is a system y is equal to x square, is it a linear system? All of you will say no. Why? There are two basic properties of a linear system. One of these is superposition and other is homogeneity. Superposition . What does this mean? This means that if you have a system, let's say this is a system, if you give it an input A, it gives an output X, let's say. If you give it an input B, it gives an output Y. And if you give an input A plus B, the output is X plus y. So if your system behaves in this manner, that if there is some random input A, your output is X, and then if there is a random another input B, and your output is Y, and when you have given A plus B into the input side and you get X plus Y into the output side, then the system is said to be a linear system. Or if you have KA, where K is some constant, Ka plus Cb, then output is Kx plus Cy, then we can say your system is a linear system. So linear system should obey superposition and homogeneity properties. And if you look at the graph of a linear, if you say that I need to visualize a system in which output is linearly increasing with the input, if we say that this is the input in on x-axis, input on x-axis and output on y-axis, then every one of you can visualize that this is a linear system. However, if I draw a system like this, is it a linear system? Ask yourself, is this system having this curve, is this a linear system? Most of you will answer no. If you are living in a room and you see the walls and the ground of the room. This is some kind of a boxed room, let's suppose. And this is the pardon my drawing. This is kind of you can say this is the floor and this is the ceiling and these are the walls. If I draw a floor separately, if you draw a line from here to here, this is the floor and you are drawing a line from here to here. So is this a linear system? You all will say yes. You are drawing a line on a floor starting from a corner and you have drawn this line, black color. So every one of you will say yes, this is a linear system. However, if I extend this line over the earth's surface, then this line will eventually form a circle around the earth. This is ground. You have drawn this line on a ground. It's like the surface of the earth. And when you extend this line up to the diameter of the earth, then this line will become a circle. What does this mean? This means that there was some system which was initially linear, but when you have kind of zoomed out that system, it became non-linear. Similarly, what happens when we say that we want to find the linear approximation of a physical system? It means that we want to look at that system for a very small kind of, you can say, very small change in input or very small change in output or for a very small duration. If I draw a sine wave like this, is this a linear system? You all will say no. However, if I show you only this portion and ask you that is this a linear system, you all will say yes. So a non-linear system can be approximated into a linear system for a very short duration of time. You can approximate any non-linear system to a linear system for a very small change in input or very small change in output, observing the system for a very short duration of time. Then we can say that we have approximated the system. We have linearly approximated the system. For example, if we take a system y equal to mx plus b, this is a very well known equation where y is the output and x is the input and b is some constant. Is this a linear system? Is this system linear? Let's check. If you give it an input x1, what would be the output? Output would be y1 is equal to mx1 plus b. If you give it an input x2, output would be y2 is equal to mx2 plus b. And if you give it an input x1 plus x2, what should be its output? If we say that it's a linear system, then its output should be y1 plus y2, whatever it is. We are giving it x1 plus x2 and its output should be y1 plus y2 if this system is linear. However, what actually happens is when you give input x1 plus x2, then its output is, let's say, y3 is equal to m x1 plus x2 plus b, which is equal to mx1 plus mx2 plus b, whereas this value equals to what is y1? y1 is mx1 plus b, and y2 is mx2 plus b. So adding these two terms, we will get mx1 plus mx2 plus b is equal to mx1 plus mx2 plus 2b. Are these both equations equal? This equation is what actually we have got, and when we give x1 plus x2 at the input. However, this equation is that what we should get if the system was linear. So as these two equations are not equal, so we can say that y is equal to mx plus b is a non-linear system. So once we have established that y is equal to mx plus b is a non-linear system, can we have its linear approximation? Let's see. So we have y equal to mx plus b. Let's give it a small rate of change of input x. Input is x, and small rate of change is x plus delta x. That x plus delta x is the small rate of change in input, then obviously output will also, there will be a small rate of change in output as well. Okay, if input is x plus delta x, then output would be y plus delta y. Obviously, if there is a small rate of change in input, then there would be a small rate of change in output. So the equation will become y plus delta y is equal to m into x plus delta x plus b for a very small rate of change in input. So expanding, y plus delta y is equal to mx plus m delta x plus b. If you visualize, this mx plus b can be replaced with y. So y plus delta y, or you can cancel this y with this mx plus b. Eventually you will get delta y is equal to m delta x. Now see that there was a constant term b which was causing problem here. The reason why these two equations were not equal was due to constant. However, in this equation you can see there is no constant present. So this equation b is linear approximation of this equation a. So equation a is a non-linear system. However, the equation b is the linearly approximated equation a. How we have linearly approximated this equation A? By having a small rate of change in input and observing that there should be a small rate of change in output, and then solving the equation, we have got the equation for a linear system. This was equation for a non-linear system. This is the same system approximated as a linear system. Now let's see how Taylor series, how can visualize the linear approximation of a Taylor series. What is a Taylor series? If we write a Taylor series, we can write as y of y of t, yeah, we can say, we can write only y is equal to gx naught, which is the initial term, plus dg over dx. X is equal to x naught, and we have x minus x naught over 1 factorial plus d square g over dx square. X is equal to x naught, x minus x naught over 2 factorial plus so on so forth. So this Taylor series, if we see, if we observe, is a non-linear system where output y and we have input x. We see that this is a non-linear equation. However, for small change, it can be approximated as a linear system. For example, if we say for a small change we ignore the higher order terms, then we will get y is equal to gx naught plus dg over dx, where x is equal to x naught and x minus x naught, plus ignored higher terms, ignored. So if we look at this equation, we see that this equation is quite similar to this equation. This is a constant. And this is, we can say, we can obviously write it as is equal to, y is equal to, this is slope m, this is delta x, this is constant, and this is y, sorry, this is kind of, this relates to this equation. And for a small rate of change, if x minus x naught is small, if the rate of change is very small, then this equation will resemble to equation B. So Taylor series can be visualized as a linear system for us for a very small rate of change, and if higher order terms are ignored. This was a kind of another example for a linear approximation of any physical system. So I think that's enough for this topic. You know that what is linear system, and we discussed the two major properties of the linear system. We discussed the shape of the linear system, and we have discussed how we can visualize the approximation, or how can we could do mathematically the linear approximation of any physical system. Now another concept that we will discuss, or we will just go through briefly, will be about, we will discuss briefly about Laplace transform. As you already have idea about Laplace transform, so we will just discuss the basics and move forward. We know that in connection to the linear transformation, instead of Taylor series, we obviously use the help of Laplace transformation for solving the algebraic equations. In the previous lectures, we looked at the mathematical modeling of a system. In mathematical modeling, we get a differential equation of a system, and that differential equation can be written in the form of a Laplace. How that equation can be written in the form of Laplace, we will see subsequently in this lecture. Last time we stopped at the point when we wrote the differential equation, and then we directly moved to its solution. We did not discuss about the Laplace transform of that differential equation. So today we will have a brief discussion about the Laplace transform of a differential equation. So just like a Fourier series we discussed in signal and system, Laplace transform also have a synthesis equation and an analysis equation. Similarly, Fourier series we studied that there were three conditions to hold a Fourier series. First was it should be the system should be the expression should be completely integrable, or it should converge. There should be minimum, there should be limited minima, maxima, and there should be a limited number of discontinuities. These were the three basic conditions we discussed for a Fourier series to hold. Similar conditions exist for Laplace transform as well. I will only write the synthesis equation and analysis equation of the Laplace, and then I will move forward to write the Laplace transform of any physical system. So if we write the synthesis equation, so synthesis equation of Laplace is f of s equal to 0 to infinity f of t e raised to the power minus st dt. You can write it as Laplace of f of t. And analysis equation, which we can also say that it's the inverse Laplace transform, is f of t is equal to 1 over 2 pi j integral from sigma minus j infinity to sigma plus j infinity f of s e raised to the power st ds. We will not evaluate this integral in this control system course. Rather, we will directly use the expression for the Laplace transform. So these expressions are just for your information. You should know that there exists a synthesis and an analysis equation for a Laplace transform, just like there exists for a Fourier series. We will directly discuss its application and usefulness. Applications and usefulness of Laplace transform. On a sider note, I think you people must know that for integration we use 1 over s in Laplace domain, and for derivative we use s. This simple knowledge will be helpful for you in writing the equations for Laplace transform of a mathematical model. For integration, 1 over s. For derivation, it's s. Okay, now I will jump directly to our discussed mass spring system. If you remember, the differential equation that we evaluated, or the mathematical model that we formed for our mass spring system in our previous lecture, was m d square y over dt square plus b dy over dt. You can say either it is y or it is x, it's same because both denote the distance. Plus ky equal to r of t. This was the equation that we formed during our discussion of a mathematical modeling in last lecture. Now we will apply Laplace transform over this equation. When we apply Laplace, we get m, and in place of d square y over dt square, we will write s square y of s minus s y of 0 negative minus dy over dt 0 negative. Now what are these two terms? These two terms basically denote your initial conditions, basically denote the response or the state of the system before time t is equal to 0. That is why it is 0 negative, plus b s y of s minus y of 0 negative. Again, this is an initial condition. Plus k y of s is equal to r of s. Again, this is also an initial condition. Now, interesting part or the conceptual part is this. When you are writing a transfer function of any system, these initial conditions are zero. This is important point to note. However, when you are writing kind of zero input response of a system, then we will take in consideration of these initial conditions. I discussed in my previous lectures that there are two types of response of a system. One is a zero input response and one is a zero state response. In zero input response, your input is zero and the output totally depends upon the initial conditions or the initial state of the system. However, in zero state response, there is no initial condition, there is no energy already present in the system, and the output solely depends on your input. You can imagine it in terms if we have an inductor or capacitor in a circuit, and if the capacitor was initially charged, so that charge in the capacitor denotes the initial condition of the capacitor, initial condition of the circuit. So if even if you are not giving any input, there would be some output, there would be some voltage appearing at the output due to that charge stored in the capacitor. So that output would be totally because of the initial state of the system. That would be zero input response. However, if there is an uncharged capacitor or totally a new system to which you are applying input for the first time, then that output that you will get will be called as zero state response of a system. For a transfer function, we take all initial conditions zero. As transfer function is output over input, or you can also say that transfer function is kind of a zero state response of a system. So obviously I will discuss both of them one by one. Now, after making this concept, if we are given with the kind of r of t is equal to 0 and y of 0 negative is equal to y naught, and dy over dt at t is equal to 0 negative is equal to 0. We are given with these three values. Then our equation will become m s square y of s minus m s y naught plus b s y s minus b y naught plus k y s is equal to 0. Okay. Now solving for output y of s, if we solve for y of s, by looking at this equation, we can write y of s is equal to m s plus b into y naught divided by m s square plus b s plus k. For these initial conditions, you have this equation. Now, if I say that our input is, here we considered input 0. Now, if I say our input is non-zero, for non-zero input and zero initial conditions, for if I write the same equation for non-zero input and zero initial conditions. Although this is not mentioned in your book in this topic, however, you should know about this. So this m s square y of s will be m s square y of s. By the way, I am assuming that you know that this how this m s square y of s came. M this m d square y over this d square y over dt square is now converted into s square in s domain, s square y of s. Similarly, then this dy over dt has been converted into s y of s in s domain. D square y s square dy is becoming xs. Similarly, if there were any integral, then there should be 1 over s. Okay, now moving back to the topic, m s square y of s, and then this is let me use another pen. Then this is zero because these both are initial conditions. We are assuming that these are zeros. Now I am going to write, because I am assuming these are zero because I am not now going to write the transfer function of this system. Bs y of s m s square y of s plus bs y of s. Now this is 0 plus k y of s. Is equal to r of s. Now we discussed that transfer function was output over input, so m s square, sorry, let me use the eraser. So taking y of s common, we have y of s common, we have m s square plus b s plus k is equal to r of s. So y of s is the output, r of s is the input, so output over input is equal to 1 over m s square plus b s plus k. This is zero state response, or we can say our transfer function of a system, transfer function of that mass spring system. Y of s is the output, r of s is the input, 1 over ms square plus bs plus k is the transfer function. Now you can see the characteristic equation in both of these system is same. 1 over ms square plus bs plus k is the characteristic equation. The roots of these characteristic equations gives you poles. You can draw the poles on S domain. If this is S is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. So if roots lie in this left half plane, then your system is a stable system. Now, if we have, let's say, K over M is equal to 2, and B over M is equal to 3. Let's say if we have K over M is equal to 2 and B over M is equal to 3, then putting these values in this equation, we will get Y of S over R of S is equal to 1 over S plus 1 into S plus 2. You can solve it by yourself as well. You will get 1 over s plus 1 into s plus 2. So it means there are two roots, one is minus 1 and one is minus 2. So one of the pole will lie, okay, let me again use another marker. So one of the pole will be at minus 1 and one of the pole will be at minus 2. One of the pole will be here and another pole will be here. So as these both poles are on the left half plane, so we can conveniently say that this system is stable. For 0, we can also see this equation. If we put k is equal to k over m is equal to 2 and b over m is equal to 3 in this as well, divided by m and putting b over m is equal to 3, then here we can have s plus 3. So we can say there is a 0 over here. So a mass spring system having this transfer function has two poles, one at minus 1, one at minus 2s, both lying in the left half plane. Hence, we can safely say that our system in this case is a stable system. That mass spring system is a stable system. For some input, if you apply some input to the mass, it will reach its steady state value. It will not become unstable. So we have found the characteristic equation. We have discussed about the poles and zeros. Poles and zeros from characteristic equation. Poles from characteristic equation, not zeros obviously. Okay. So this was the application and usefulness of a Laplace transform. We took the help of Laplace. We wrote our equation of mass spring system, differential equation of mass spring system in Laplace domain, S domain. Then we discussed that we have two ways, either we take input is equal to zero and find the response due to initial conditions, or we take input conditions equal to zero and find response due to R of T or R of S. Then we derived this equation, which is actually the transfer function of your mass spring system. So if we further solve this equation, how can we solve this equation, by the way? If you visualize, this equation can be solved with the help of partial fractions. This equation can be solved with the help of partial fraction, like y of s is equal to k1 is some residue divided by s plus 1 plus k2 is some other residue divided by s plus 2. So by partial fractions we can get k1 is equal to 2, so we have 2 over s plus 1, and k2 is 1 minus 1, sorry, so we have minus 1 over s plus 2. So from here, by using tables for the inverse Laplace transform, we can get y of t is equal to 2 e raised to the power minus t minus 1 e raised to the power minus 2t. So we can solve this differential equation with the help of Laplace transform. Now Laplace transform has enabled us to find the transfer function and to find the time response of a system by using partial fractions. This was a second order differential equation. We used Laplace to find the equation of second order differential equation in terms of Laplace or in the S domain. Then we wrote the transfer function, and then we solved that second order differential equation and derived or evaluated its time domain response. Obviously these residues can also be evaluated with the help of choosing any other graphical techniques, but eventually we have the required tools to solve a second order differential equation and find the time response of a system. You see that we can get the exponential time response. for your mass spinning system. So this you can visualize that this is all the extension of the mathematical modeling of a system. You had a physical system which was a mass spring system. You first of all using Newton's law of F is equal to ma, you wrote its second order differential equation. Then you converted that second order differential equation into S domain equation using Laplace. Then that was actually a tool that you used to find the transfer function of your system, that is relation between output and input. So these mathematical tools are helping you to proceed with your calculation or to find the stability of a system or whatever the information you need. So from the transfer function, you have visualized the poles and zeros of a system. From transfer function has enabled you, which is also obviously a tool of a mathematical modeling. It has enabled you to find the roots of the system and to find the poles and zeros of the system. If the poles are on the left hand side, you can say that your system is a stable system. And that Laplace also helped you to find a time response of a system. So initially we had a physical system. That physical system was converted into differential equation. That differential equation was converted into Laplace. Laplace helped us to find its transfer function. Transfer function helped us to find its poles. And poles helped us to find its stability. So this is the beauty of a mathematical modeling. This chain, complete chain, is a mathematical modeling of a system. And from Laplace, you can also find the time response. You can also find a time response of your system. Okay. So next thing that I would like to discuss in extension to this mathematical modeling, actually there are few important concepts that you should keep in your mind before we move further. So now we will discuss few very basic concepts which will help you in your lab manuals as well. So another thing is final or steady state value. How can you find a final value or a steady state value of a system? For example, if you say that go to the discussion of the lecture one where we discussed the turning on of a fan, we said that there was initially 0 volt and we applied, let's say, 220 volt. Now what was the final voltage that was actually applied to the system? System response was like this, we initially discussed, and we said that there was a difference between the desired output versus the actual output, and we called this difference as a steady state error. Now what is this actual output for any system, for any generic system? For any generic system, when you give it an input, when you give an input to a generic system, to any system, to which output it will get settled? We want to find its value when it will get settled. That is the final value of the system, or steady state value. Final value or the steady state value. Final value, by definition, we can get the final value of a system by applying limit t approaches infinity to our output y of t. This should give us the value of our output y of t at t is equal to infinity. Means we would like to see that at infinite time, what would be the value at which our system is settled. However, in a few cases, evaluating this expression is somehow cumbersome or mathematically not possible due to the addition of or due to the involvement of this infinity factor. So alternatively this value can also be evaluated with the help of our Laplace equation. We already know y of s over here. So either you put t is equal to infinity in time domain equation, or you put limit s approaches 0 s y of s. You multiply your y of s with s and put s is equal to 0. Most of you would be thinking that due to s is equal to 0, this s y of s, this complete term would be 0. This would not be the case, because this s might have been cancelled with something in denominator of the y of s. So don't get confused. So just focus on this, that the value that you can get by putting t is equal to infinity in this expression in y of t would be the same value if you put s is equal to 0 in y of s and multiplying it with s. This is called a final value theorem. This expression complete is called a final value theorem, and it enables us to find a final value or the steady state value of our response. To hold this the condition to hold this final value theorem is the system should be stable. If the system is stable, only then this final value theorem will hold. Obviously, if a system is stable, only in that case you would have a steady output. You would have a constant output. If the system is unstable, system wouldn't settle. So if the system doesn't settle, it means that it doesn't have any final value. So if the system would only have a final value only if it is stable. So this expression, this final value theorem, will hold only if, only when the system is, this system you are dealing with is a stable system. Now we have discussed the final value theorem. There are two other important terms that you should know. One is the damping ratio. Next thing that I am going to discuss is damping ratio, natural frequency, what is a overdamped response, underdamped response, and critically damped response. These are the next conceptual things that I am going to discuss with you. Okay, after discussing the final value theorem, let's now go back to the mass spring system. Let me use another pen. Okay, the equation we got for y of s was y of s is equal to s plus b over m y naught divided by s square plus b over m into s plus k over m. Basically, you need to write this characteristic equation in the form of s square plus something into s plus some constant y. Because the standard characteristic equation for a second order system looks like this. s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. You should know about this equation and you should maybe memorize this equation, because in order to find omega n and zeta you need to have this equation. So how does this equation help us? What is this equation telling us and how does this equation help us? This equation is telling us that your characteristic equation can have the insights about a characteristic damping ratio as well as the natural frequency of the system. This is an ordinary characteristic equation. However, this equation is telling you that this is not an ordinary equation. You use this characteristic equation to find natural frequency and damping ratio of a system. This equation is basically telling you that the values of natural frequency and damping ratio are hidden in your characteristic equation, and this equation will help you to find out those hidden values inside your characteristic equation. Zeta is the damping ratio and omega n is the basically the natural frequency. Zeta is the damping ratio. Means what is damping ratio? Damping ratio means for example, when you are driving a car and there is a speed breaker, you have your car have good shocks, then when your car passes over the speed breaker, then it will the car will dampen its effect. If you see the mass spring system, if you push this mass downwards and then release it, the spring will move to and forth, up and down. The spring will move up and down with some oscillation till it is again at stationary position. So these oscillations or these ripples characterizes the system. How fast the system is being damped or how slow the system is being damped, depending upon which factors or which type of spring you are using, which K you are using, which frictional constant you are using. So these all factors contributes towards the damping of your system, and this damping of the system gives you a damping ratio. Damping ratio is basically the actual damping versus the critical damping of your system. Why it is called a ratio? Because there is an actual damping. For example, when you have there is some value of spring, there is spring constant K, your spring constant has some value K, your mass has some value M, and your frictional constant has some value B. For example, this B, M and K have some values. Now when you pull this mass downwards, the amount it takes, the time it takes to get back to the stationary position or get back to the equilibrium state, or rather I will use the word get back to the steady state, that time is important. If your system is overdamped, system has an excessive damping. If your system is overdamped, then it will take a larger time to reach to the steady state. However, there will be no ripples or no oscillations. If your system is underdamped, system might come to your steady state sooner, but it will have lot of ripples. However, if your system is critically damped, then your system will reach to its steady state value as soon as possible with minimum ripples. So you obviously want that your system should be critically damped. So the ratio between the actual damping the actual damping, the practical, the actual result of your practical system, the actual damping values, the actual damping of the system divided by the critical damping basically gives you the damping ratio. Means how good is the damping of your system, that is defined by this zeta or damping ratio. Now how can you find a damping ratio of any system? This is by comparing that characteristic equation of your system with this standard equation, standard second order equation. This standard second order equation is telling you that your characteristic equation has hidden the value of zeta and omega n in itself. For example, if we compare, then we will get zeta omega n is equal to b over m. This zeta omega n is equal to b over m, and omega n square is equal to k over m, which means omega n, which is the natural frequency of the system, is equal to under root k over m. Putting this value of omega n in over here, we will get zeta is equal to b over 2 under root km. Where this zeta is actually the damping ratio of your system, and omega n of your this. Now we are talking typically or specially about your mass spring system. This equation A, gives you the natural frequency of your mass spring system, of your physical mass spring system, which we discussed earlier. And this equation B gives you the damping ratio of your mass spring system. So if we extend this chain, we can say that from transfer function we can also find damping ratio and your natural frequency of your system. So now you would have idea that how a mathematical modeling of any physical system helps us to look inside into the system, into the characteristics of the system, into the damping ratio of the system, into the how you can find the damping ratio of the system using mathematical modeling. You can find the natural frequency of the system using mathematical modeling. You can find the stability of the system using mathematical modeling. You can find the time response of the system using mathematical modeling, poles of the system. So that is why the mathematical modeling of the system is important. This was what I told you while I started this mathematical modeling, that why this modeling is important. Now obviously you would have started to realize this, or you would have started to see it by yourself, that why this mathematical important is of critical importance in your control system and how it helps us to study any system. So we were talking about this zeta, which is the damping ratio, and this omega n, which is actually the defines or which tells you about the natural frequency of the system. So you can see by changing this k and m, you can change the value of zeta. Here as well, you can change the value of k and m, and you change the value of omega. What does it mean? It means, sorry, by k and m and also b. It means that by using specific value of frictional element b, your specific value of k spring constant and m mass, the combination of spring constant, frictional constant and mass, all of three combined gives you the zeta. If b, k and m, the values of b, k and m are in such a way that zeta is greater than 1, then the roots of your characteristic equation will be real. And you can say the system would be overdamped. And when your values of B, K and M are set in such a way that your zeta is less than 1, then your roots are complex conjugate. And your response of the system would be underdamped. And if this B, K and M, values of B, K and M are set in such a way that your zeta is equal to 1, then roots are repeated and real. Roots of characteristic equation are repeated and real because you can see that this B, K and M are eventually the part of the characteristic equation. So if you set in these values in such a way that zeta becomes 1, then roots of this characteristic equation would be repeated and real, and you can say the response of the system would be critically damped. Now if I want to visualize the responses, these three responses, overdamped, underdamped and critically damped responses, let's try to draw these responses. Let me make some place. I think I have no page left over here. So let's go back and draw this overdamped, underdamped and critically damped response. Now, if this is your desired output, or you can say the final value or anything, the underdamped response would be like this. And it settles to its, this is the steady state value. I'm just trying to get make you people visualize what these three types of responses mean. And when the system is overdamped, the kind of response would be like this, overdamped, suppressed response. And when the system would be critically damped, so I might not be able to make good drawings, but to give you basic concept, in overdamped response, the ripples are killed, kind of. The ripples are killed, but your steady state is achieved, or the steady state value is achieved a bit late. In underdamped response, there are a lot of oscillations. If you are imagine you are traveling in a car, and the shock system that is installed in a car has an underdamped response, then you can imagine how much oscillations you will feel due to that speed breaker if your system response is underdamped. So this black line is underdamped response, blue line is overdamped response, and red line is critically damped response. So this critically damped response reaches its steady state or equilibrium value at optimum time and with minimum ripples. However, in overdamped, ripples are almost killed. However, it reached the steady state a bit late, in underdamped, there are a lot of overshoots, there are a lot of ripples. This is called overshoot. There are a lot of overshoots, there are a lot of ripples. However, the system reaches its steady state value earlier, but still, you can say that this underdamped response is obviously not desirable. These are two extremes, underdamped and overdamped are obviously two extremes. So system which is a critically damped system and have a damping ratio is equal to 1 would be obviously a good system. So to make a system overdamped, you set the value of B, K and M such that your zeta, which is B over 2 into Km, is greater than 1, then roots are real and your system is overdamped. And if zeta is less than 1, roots are complex conjugate and system is underdamped, and zeta is equal to 1, system is repeated, roots are repeated and real. Whose roots? The roots of this characteristic equation would be repeated and real, and system would be said to be a critically damped system. So to recap, what we learned today is, first of all, we studied what is the linear approximation of a physical system. For that, we discussed what is actually a linear system. Linear system had two major properties, superposition and homogeneity, and we visualized a linear system in terms of a graph, and then we visualized a non-linear system in terms of a graph. We took an example of Earth, that Earth is a circle. Circle is a non-linear system. However, when we look at your floor of a room, then and draw a line from its corner, then it is a linear line. So that is why we observed that if you take a very small portion of the Earth, then obviously you can approximate that as a linear system. Similarly, we saw an example of a sine wave. Sine wave was actually a non-linear system. However, for a very small area, for a very small observation area, this is a linear system. So how to approximate a linear system to a non-linear system to a linear system? We discussed that we should limit our area of observation and see the system for a very short change in input. Then we converted a non-linear system y is equal to mx plus b, not converted but approximated. We approximated a non-linear system y is equal to mx plus b to a linear system. Delta y is equal to delta m delta x. Then we took linear approximation of your Taylor series as an example. Then we discussed the Laplace equations. Laplace transform have two basic equations. One is synthesis equation, one is analysis equation. And then there are three properties. There are three conditions to hold Laplace transform. The integral should be this f of t. Integral of f of t should be should converge. Should be integrable, and it should have limited minima maxima and limited number of discontinuities. Then we discuss the application and usefulness of the Laplace transform in your mass spring system. We took the differential equation of a mass spring system, applied Laplace, and then considered two cases. One was when there were initial conditions and input was zero, and second case we considered when the input was there but initial conditions were zero, and we said that that is actually that scenario gives you the transfer function. Then taking that forward, we discussed that we can find the poles and zeros of a system using that using characteristic equation of a transfer function, and further we can use this transfer function to find the time response of a system using partial fractions. And this was the chain that we discussed previously. And then this transfer function, from this transfer function, we can find the damping ratio and the natural frequency of the system. Damping ratio, why it is called a damping ratio? Because it's the ratio of the actual damping divided by the critical damping. And we discussed about the final value theorem. What is the final, how can we find the steady state or the final value of a system? We can either put t is equal to infinity in our y of t, or we can put s is equal to 0 in our y of s equation that we obtained from Laplace. Now, one last interesting thing is that if we move this zeta, this is kind of interesting as well as it is important. When we change the value of b, m or k, when we change the value of b, m and k, you can see the roots of these this characteristic equation are changing. For zeta greater than 1, real, repeated and real, complex conjugate. So it means by having different values of mass, by having different values of spring, by having different values of frictional element, you would have a different characteristic equation every time and you would have a different zeta every time. So what does it mean having a different zeta every time? When you are changing b, k and m, you are having different zeta every time, you are having different characteristic equation every time, you are having different roots every time. What does it mean? If I am saying that you are having different roots every time, it means that your poles are moving. Zeta is changing, poles are moving. So when the zeta is changed by changing bk and m, your characteristic equation is changed, your roots are different, your poles are different. So for a same system, by changing the values of constants, or in same assembly of a system, just by changing the values of system parameters, you can have different zeta, you can have different pole locations. So zeta is dependent upon the system internal parameters, which in this case are b, k and m. So when zeta is changing, roots are moving, poles are moving. Zeta is changing, poles are moving. Now the fashion in which poles are moving is called root locus. This is important concept. The fashion in which your poles are moving is called a root locus. So root locus is the path that roots adapt when you change your input parameters. You change your b, k and m for a same physical system. When you change b, k and m, your zeta is changed, your characteristic equation is changed, roots of characteristic equations are changed, your pole location is different. However, the poles always follow a specific path for any system. For this mass spring system, for this under discussion mass spring system, poles follow a circular path. No matter what value you take of B, K and M, the pole will always lie on this semicircle. If your zeta is 1, pole will lie here. If your zeta is greater than 1, maybe if your zeta is 0, maybe pole will lie here. For zeta less than 1, maybe pole lie on this portion of a circle. Whatever the zeta is, whatever the values of b, k and m, your pole will always lie in this semicircle. It means your pole will always lie in this left half plane. It means for any b, k and m, your system is always a stable system. So in this case, when you are designing a system, how this information helps you? When you are designing any input, when you are designing any system and you are afraid that by with the passage of time or by using the system in a you can say rough manner, your internal system parameters would be changed. If you make your system rugged so that whatever the internal parameters are changing, whether it is due to season, whether it is due to temperature, your system should not go into the instability region. So this is basically the operating region of your mass spring system. Maybe at some point where mass exceeds some limit, or when mass is too large, it will move to the right half plane and then system will be unstable. Obviously every system is stable for a range of change in input parameters. When input parameters or system parameters, or when the system parameters are changed outside that range, the system will go into the unstable region and system will become unstable. If you are driving a car, there is always a limit on RPM. If you are driving a car within that RPM limit, your car is safe, your car is stable. No matter what are the RPMs, your car is stable. You are driving a car at 1000 RPM, you are driving a car at 2000 RPM, 3000, 4000, 5000, your car is still stable. However, if you exceed certain limit, your car will become obviously unstable. So every system has some operating range. So using this characteristic, using this relationing, we can find the range, operating range of your any system. You want to find that due to which parameter your system can possibly go to the unstable state. You can find that by using this analysis. Obviously, because B, K and M, all of these three are in your hand. You have the range of B, you have range of K, you have range of M. You change these in whatever manner, you have operating range of this B, K and M. So you can increase M up to certain level, you can increase K up to certain level, you can increase B up to certain level. For all these levels, your roots shall lie in the left half plane and the system will be stable. However, if you increase M beyond certain limit, if you increase K beyond certain limit, if you increase B beyond certain limit, then there is a possibility that these roots might go into the unstable region. These poles might go into the unstable region and your system will become unstable. So by that, you can also define your maximum and minimum range of these B, K and M. You are designing an amplifier, you can obviously design your you can obviously give a range of your volume. You limit your volume to a certain level that your system should not become unstable. This applies to every possible system. Every possible system where you want to provide the user with a range of input, or with a range of operating conditions, or with a range of with the diverse atmospheric or temperature conditions. You want that your end user should be able to use the system in winter, summer, outside, inside, in all conditions. Then obviously you will design the system in such a way that the temperature range for which the system can possibly be operated should be the system should be operated for that temperature in stable region. That temperature should not cause that system to go into the unstable region. So by that, you can define your limits, you can extend your limits of the system, or you can contract your limit of the systems, your system. You can design your system, you can model your system. So that is why mathematical modeling is of critical importance. What has enabled you to make these decisions? Mathematical modeling has enabled you to make these decisions. This root locus has enabled you to make these decisions. This movement of poles, this changing of zeta, this changing of BK and M, everything is connected, everything is interlinked and gives you the characteristics of the system, insights into the system, and helps you to design a system. So today's lecture was specifically important as we discussed very critical concepts about the mathematical modeling of the control systems. In the next lecture, we will see the transfer function of the system in more detail. However, there are some lab manuals from this specific lecture, so that you would be following. Again, in case of any query, you can write to me, you can email me, or email address like always right at the end of the lecture. Email address is rafe.chughtai@uet.edu.pk. Okay, thank you very much. See you in the next lecture. Inshallah. Allah Hafiz.